time of Malcolm and Margaret, but in 1072, Malcolm founded the church which was dedicated to the Holy Trinity. And from that time, the place of royal sepulture was within its walls. Many royal gifts were given to the church. Crucifix of gold, silver vessels, jewels and a black cross full of diamonds, which Margaret brought out of England. We knew Margaret as a saint then, though it was not until 1240 that the Holy Father canonized her officially and her beautiful shrine was built. Still, I contend that she continued to help the people of Scotland. Her spirit rose, like mine, in 1236. On the eve of battle, it was believed by the Scots that the royal tombs at Dunfermline Abbey gave up their dead and that they passed through its northern courts to war against the Knight of Norway. Sometimes I long to rest my bones, but in my long pilgrimage haunting these stones, I've seen great things. Our Church of the Holy Trinity became a great abbey thanks to David I, with 13 Chaldean monks of the Order of Iona and 13 Benedictine monks from Canterbury. Our order worked the land and began to mine the rich reserves of coal beneath the ground. By 1300, we had one of the richest abbeys of the country and had lands, rents, and churches from Pluscarden in the north to Coldingham in the borders. The kings and queens were buried here at the royal sepulchre, and although King Robert the Bruce sent his heart to the Holy Land, it was here that his body was laid to rest. 8 kings of Scotland are laid to rest here. Malcolm III, Duncan II, Edgar, Alexander, David I, Malcolm IV, Alexander III, and Robert I, King Robert the Bruce. Along with 4 queens, 7 princes and princesses, and ordinary folk too. Sir William Wallace's mother died in 1303 and was buried at a spot now in the northern churchyard marked by a thorn tree, which used to be the site of the Abbey Weeping Cross. I feel I'm fading again.